Desde el 18 de noviembre hasta el 2 de diciembre vamos a estar aquí en Media Lab y vamos a tener entre 6 y 8 grupos que van a desarrollar entre 6 y 8 proyectos, que lo estamos justo ahora seleccionando, dado que la convocatoria se cerró ayer. Y va a haber 3 mentores presenciales y uno virtual, que va a ser Auditán, que luego también vendrá presencialmente la última semana, pero la idea es que estos mentores estén ayudando a que los proyectos se orienten de la manera más eficiente posible, productiva posible, y potencien las ideas más interesantes dentro de todo el grupo que se creen que en torno a cada proyecto. Entonces, la idea, Auditán nos sugirió esta idea de hacer un experimento de presencia virtual, que quiere decir que parte del tiempo ya no estará, pero habrá una especie de robot que será ella, que en vez de ver los planetas con las gafas, como estamos viendo aquí, lo que verá será nosotros trabajando, ¿no? Entonces se podrá acercar a una mesa y hablar con la gente de ese grupo, podrá ver el trabajo que están haciendo, podrá ver las pantallas de los ordenadores, podrá ver los gráficos que estén haciendo, etcétera, y podrá hablar con la gente. Entonces, la idea de este taller es justamente comenzar la construcción de ese robot de presencia virtual que va a estar funcionando aquí a partir del 18 de noviembre y que ya pretendemos que sea una infraestructura de Media Lab más, que la pueda usar cualquier persona. Para ello debemos conseguir más cámaras. We should, after you take your cameras, we have to buy some for Media Lab. Yes. If this experience is successful.
Yeah, well, it's 200 euros.
Sure. Okay. Entonces la idea es que hoy Auditán nos introduzca las tecnologías de realidad virtual, de participación a través de realidad virtual, y luego a partir de las 12:30 empezaremos con el taller, en el cual ya empezaremos a especificar exactamente qué es lo que queremos construir, cómo vamos a construir, ver qué personas han venido para colaborar en la construcción y básicamente diseñar lo que vamos a tener funcionando aquí ya en noviembre. Entonces, bueno, pues, mejor con Audi, que disfruten.
Thank you, everybody. So, just to remind people, if you have a phone or anything that can connect to the internet, please go to, and that includes you, Yano, go to remesh.net/lab, because that's where really the talk will take place. I'm very happy to be here, and I will learn Spanish as I speak slow English at this talk. And if you need interpretation, or if I speak too fast, or if there's anything that I don't say clearly, please just raise your hand, or not even raise your hand, just interrupt me, and then we can talk more detail there. Okay, right. So basically, on the Remesh, I will start with saying exactly what I'm going to say in the next section, maybe 10 minutes or so of my talk, and then I will ask you some questions, okay? So just to practice, I will announce that for my next section, I will say about that Taiwan has a new president, an independent premier, and a politics that is post-party, that is not affected by political party anymore. And that is going to be the focus for the next 10 minutes of my talk. But then I will also use this tool, Remesh, to ask for your ideas. So as you can see, people are going online. We can see 7 people online, 9 people online, and so on. Oh, I can even use my hotel network. I don't use my hotel network. Okay, right. And then on that page, I will start asking you questions. So I usually start by asking, what do you feel at the moment? Like, what do you feel about this talk, this whole thing, and like, what's your feeling at the moment? And then, so for the next 3 minutes, you will see on your phone or your device, and if you didn't bring one, it's fine. You can just look at the screen here, which is going to project it really soon, to see that people is answering the questions together. And And so, and we do have a backup projection, so I can switch to here. Okay, so as you can see, there is a 3-minute limit from me that I was asking the people here for 3 minutes, what are your feelings? And then for the first minute or so, you will ask for your feelings, and then some basic profile, like do you work in the public service or do you work in private sector? And then after that, it will ask you to see other people's feelings and rank people's feelings that's closer to you. So by the end, this is basically a what we call a synthesis, a merge of people's opinions. And then this process is crowdsourced, meaning that not a moderator, not me, or a artificial intelligence is doing the synthesis, but the people yourselves, people who participate to share your feelings, is doing the synthesis by yourself to try to come up with something that synthesizes everybody's feelings. And so this is basically how we merge people's ideas and feelings and thoughts around one particular subject. And this is going to be the first part of my talk. So without further ado, I'll just open my slides and get on with the talk. So if you didn't connect or if there's some Wi-Fi problem, it's not a problem. It's just to let people know what kind of experience that I have as a moderator to this kind of public discussion. So even though we have just 4 responses and it's crowdsourced by people participating themselves, we can still have some charts. Basically, the popularity and the degree of consensus really what people feel about it. And then there is a voting period that will say how much it was liked. So like it's favorable, meaning that most people converge to it here. Right? So people suggest that I have to come to live here in Madrid and be a virtual minister in Taiwan, so so that I live here and it's a great hospitality, great food, and great weather, and it's and then I work a telecommute as a minister. I actually entertained that idea, and I talked with my prime minister about that. How do you feel about a cabinet member that is actually in Europe all the time? And he said to me, as long as it's no longer than 2 weeks. Every month, he is fine with that. So I can have 2 weeks every month. So for example, for November, I will use the last week of November to be here and the first weeks of December to be in Paris. So it's actually more than 3 weeks. It's a hack of the 2 calendar months that I still get to spend in a month. We'll see if our prime minister likes it. But it's true that I will still be traveling and visiting you friends around here. So this is great. So let's have the talk. So this talk actually I gave first in a very quick way, and I posted a YouTube video to Remesh so people can check it out afterwards. So I will just talk in very brief, broad sketches. Taiwan, as of now, has moved to a post-party political system. The majority of our cabinet is independent. my colleagues, the ministers, the majority of them belong to no parties. It's very interesting because in that climate, people generally experiment more, and we're trying to, my position as a conservative anarchist in the cabinet is to try to move the cabinet to a way where people are post-ideology. That would take a longer time, but post-political party is a start. And this is made possible because in May, when I was giving the talk here, we have a new president, Dr. Tsai Ing-wen, and she is very progressive by East Asian standards, somewhat progressive by European standards, and I voted for her. We share similar values. I am an animal rights activist, a supporter of animal rights activism. I live with 7 cats and 2 dogs, and she is a fellow animal welfare supporter, and with values like aborigine rights, like biodiversity, like marriage equality, and animal welfare, animal rights, and abolition of capital punishment. That makes her very radical in East Asia and somewhat progressive here. So it's pretty good that we have a president like that, and she is not married or partnered. So this is our first family. She also lives with 2 cats and 3 Labrador dogs. And the good thing about the first family is you cannot bribe the first family. You cannot pay, or you can use catnip or other food, but they will not suggest public construction projects for the president. It's a very good first family. They're incorruptible. But in Taiwan, we had an election for the president in January, but she comes to office at May. So there were 4 months of transition time where the losing party, the Nationalist Party, transferred the administrative power, and also the MPs for the first time, they lose the majority of the parliament at the time, the ruling Nationalist Party. But before in Taiwan, we had 3 this kind of transitions from one party to another. And every time it appeared on international news, because it was very violent, the older people here may remember Taiwan as a place where parliament MPs throw chairs at each other and fight in the parliament. That was 20 or even 16 years ago. But this time, for the 4 months of transition in this year, there is no international news because it was absolutely peaceful. There is no fighting, there's no bickering. And the reason is the outgoing prime minister, our previous prime minister and my mentor, Simon Zhang Sanzhen, is independent. He belongs to no parties. And before he joined the national government, he was the regional director at Google in Asia. So he is trained as Taiwan's first supercomputing hacker. And so basically you had a hacker as the prime minister, and he is absolutely peaceful. Because when he was our digital and science minister, he contributed to this open source mandate. In other countries, in European countries, we hear that people pass laws that says all the public inquiry data must be open data, or all the environmental data must be open data, and things like these laws, right? Transparency laws. But he, Simon, passed a regulation that says everything that is less than 1 million euros a year that's funded by public money must be open data, no exceptions. And so, and of course, national security and privacy must be taken into account. But other than that, there is no exceptions. So everything must be open data from all the ministries. And even though some ministries used to sell the data, they cannot do that anymore. It must be open data. And so because of this, Taiwan became the number 1 in the global open data index just over 1 year. We used to be at the 11th place in the open knowledge index, but we are now at the top place because it's a top-down mandate. And then something more amazing happened. The new president came when she appointed a new prime minister, Lin Quan, an economist. He also belonged to no parties. He never joined any parties. He's respected as an independent scholar. So the 2 prime ministers who are independent arranged something we've never seen before in Taiwan. the Prime Minister from Google, that's Album Premier, asked all the ministries to save a checkpoint document that details whatever policy they're doing, what are doing in the middle, where was the original direction, and upload everything to the internet, and ask the new Prime Minister to download from the internet, along with everybody else on the planet, the checkpoint document of the previous administration, and talk about handover the transition based on those public documents and the open data evidence that supports these policies. So this is not one party transferring power to another party. This is one party dissolving the power to everybody and for the next cabinet to carry over in a very transparent way. And this is good because then the next cabinet would not say, okay, these are the, you know, our enemies' policy and we'll cancel them. But it's already talked with the public. And so many of the policies actually continued after the transition. It was very peaceful. And this is not just the two prime ministers. Our mayor of the capital city, Taipei City, He Wenzhe, also was a surgeon, and he belonged to no party, never was a politician. But he was elected the mayor because he was an occupier. He was part of the Occupy movement. And I think something happened here very closely, and also in other Spanish cities, and maybe in Barcelona, right? And so basically, of the mayor election at that year in 2014, of the six metropolis areas, five of them was won by occupiers or supporters of occupiers, and two of them didn't even expect to be elected. They were surprised when they were elected. They didn't know that they would become mayors. So that's a new thing in Taiwan. And also our vice president, who was into epidemics, is also independent. So as I mentioned, after three decades of two-party system and very political fighting, it was finally broke free by the Occupy movement in 2014, when we occupied the parliament for 22 days. And we occupied the parliament, the students who did it, not because they want to protest something, but because the MPs at that time, our legislators, refused to deliberate an agreement with Beijing and a trade agreement with Beijing. And their thought at that time, their constitutional thought, is that they think Beijing is a domestic city of Taiwan. And by law, domestic agreements doesn't go through the parliament. It's an administration signing with the city. So because it's just a city government, Beijing government, they don't want to deliberate. Now, nobody really believes Beijing is part of the Taiwan. Not even Beijing people believe that. So it is a very tricky way for them to not deliberate. But because we elected them to deliberate for us, right, it's representative democracy. When they refuse their job, it's as if they went on a strike, right? They don't want to do the job. So the students who occupied the parliament peacefully said, okay, you don't want to do the job, so we will do the job ourselves. We will use deliberative democracy methods to go through the agreement one line by one line, and then we will deliberate with anyone who wants to show up during the 20 days, and there's 500,000 people who showed up to talk about this in a proper way, and it's called the Sunflower Movement. And my role at the movement was not the really occupy. I only was there for 1 hour to set up this equipment. After that, I was part of the GovZero movement, who is a kind of collective to build a shadow government. Well, our work is through this domain name called g0v.tw. And then, because all the government websites in Taiwan ends on gov.tw, okay? So for the environmental agency, env.gov.tw, we built a shadow environmental agency called env.g0v.tw. The legislative, ly.gov.tw, we built a shadow legislative, ly.g0v.tw. So any government website, if you change the O to a zero, you get to the shadow government. And it solves a very important problem, it's the discovery problem, right? For the normal civic tech, if you have a new website, it's hard to remember the website. But But this way, everybody remembers the website because it's the same as the national government's website, just with one bit of difference. And after we built this website, we also worked on a translation of the trade service agreement into visualization, into comics, into things that people can understand. So we built a tool that let people see exactly how does the trade service agreement affect them, and that formed the basis of an informed deliberation on the street, attended by 250,000 people and more online. This is how we were setting up the infrastructure. But we, the hundreds of people working for GovZero, we have our day jobs. I was an Apple consultant at the time. We have people working at Google, people working in Acer, in HTC, and in all the large companies in the technological world. But when the Occupy happened, we all just told our company that we need to take a leave for 3 weeks. And because the country is calling, democracy is calling, and we will join the people on the street. But why are we doing this? Why are there hundreds of civic hackers who want to volunteer for democracy? It's because when we were learning computers in the 1988, when Apple II and IBM PC was first appearing, that was also when Taiwan lifted the press, the ban, the censorship. Before that, for 30 years, Taiwan was under a dictatorship, just like here, the Chiang Kai-shek dictatorship. And the martial law, the dictatorship went on for 30 years. It was a time of torture, a time of very Stasi-like surveillance. It was a time that was very brutal for 30 years. And then after that, we democratized, but that was only in the late 80s. And it's the same time as personal computers. And after we work on the democratic system, we finally have a direct vote for the president. That was in 1996, not so long ago. It was just 20 years ago. And 20 years ago was also the time when World Wide Web becomes popular in Taiwan. So for our generation, we are the first generation that can do democracy. And then we are also the first generation that does internet or does civic tech. So for us, civic and tech, they're the same thing. They're the same bunch of people. They're not two kinds of people. They're the same generation of people. So when we see free software, we think freedom, liberty, freedom of expression. While as in other East Asian countries, when they see free software, they see no cost. It's free to use. And then maybe you can change, but that's secondary. But for us, the freedom part is really the first part, and it's just incidentally you can obtain it with no cost. So for the Sunflower deliberation on the trade service agreement, we used the focused conversation method to listen to millions of people on the street, well, half a million people on the street. First, we have the facts. That is to say, on our website, you can enter your company's name or your company's ID number, and then we will show you in a three-panel comic exactly which line in the trade service agreement affects you. Or maybe you're not affected, which is fine, right? If you don't work in trade, you work in manufacturing, it just shows, okay, you're not affected. And then, so you don't have to read through 500 pages of international agreements like TPP or TPIP from WikiLeaks. You can just see exactly the part that you're interested in. And then we cite, of course, the source, so you can see that we're neutral. And then we work with professional facilitators to ask people the question that I just asked you: what are your feelings? What do you feel about the part that affects you? And when we capture, synthesize all the feelings, and there's no right or wrong about feelings. You can feel angry and feel happy about a certain set of facts. But then we bring in the experts. The experts serve as a neutral counseling person who try to distill people's ideas. And on the idea stage, we rank ideas. The best ideas are the ideas that takes care of the most feelings of people. So if one idea takes care of 80% of people's feelings, it's a better idea than an idea that takes care only a minority of people's feelings. So we rank idea and try to get consensus on the ideas. And finally, we do the synthesis, which is taking the highest ranked ideas to ask people whether you agree with this. And if people agree, we write a synthetic argument as we did during the Occupy and distill it into 6 points. And then we send it with supporting evidence to the head of the parliament, the chief MP, and say, your people refuse to do your job. So we used your office to do your job for 20 days. And now we have a result document. And as the head of the parliament, do you agree? Do you agree with this people's voice that we have synthesized? And the head of parliament said, yes, you did a really good job. Thank you for doing the job for my people. Well, for my staff, right, for the MPs. So basically it is a demonstration, but not protesting. It's a demo, right? It's a demo of saying, if the MPs refuse to do their jobs, the occupiers can do their job and do their job better than the MPs on this very specific issue. And so when the head of the parliament says, okay, I agree to be bound by your consensus, something very magical is happening. It's the first time in Taiwan where a head of a representative democracy says, I accept 100% the result of a direct democracy method. And so after that, we see a lot of experimentation because millions of people have participated in this process of direct democracy. So again, facts, feelings, ideas, and then synthesis. And this is a different model. The late MPs was working on another model, right? It's what we call the old politics. It involves expert language, only understood by the public servants and the private sector, the commercial lobbyists. I say it in a neutral way. The commercial lobbyists who share some information with the government to form policy, but also keep some information among themselves to work as private sector members. Of course, the process also includes civil society, like academics, scholars, independent experts. But they don't have a natural upstream and downstream link, a link of interest of stake like the private sector. So they're somewhat isolated. But the main problem is that the language used here is not the same set of language as used on the street. So for contentious issues like energy policy, people on the street actually have a different set of facts than the set of facts that is used by professional experts in private sector. And that creates a huge problem because we cannot even agree on basic facts. And if we don't have a basic facts as the foundation, then we don't have a way to listen to each other's feelings. Because you feel happy and I feel angry, but we're feeling happy and angry on different things. So it's impossible for us to meet because we're really talking past each other. But often in this case, on the parliament and on the street, people still have ideas, right? It's not like people don't have ideas, but their ideas, because it's not based on shared feelings and facts, they become ideologies. They become virus of the mind, that if you are hit with this kind of virus, it spreads, you cough, and you try to spread the ideology to the people around you because it's infectious. It feels good to shout your ideology. And then when that happens, and people become affected by the ideology, there are symptoms, they become sick. And the sickness blinds us to new facts. It blinds us to other people's feelings. Whatever the new facts arise, whatever the other feelings, we just keep shouting the same ideology, right? So we become like zombies, or if you have played Pokemon Go, we become like Pokemon Go trainers who are formed by the ideologies. But unlike Pokemon Go, which is more like a common flu, after 3 days you develop antibody to the game, ideologies like this, they deepen and then they blind us to the feelings. Which is why we're not doing open data just for open data's sake. We're doing open data as the foundation of the dialogue that is published by the government and also by the private sector and the civil society. So, this is the first part of my talk. It took maybe 20 minutes, and it's very abstract. I'm going to use a very concrete case in the next 10 minutes to talk exactly how it works on the city level. Okay? Is that okay with people? Okay. So for the next 10 minutes, I'm going to talk about exactly how we apply this method in Taipei City. And it's the work of my colleague and very good friend, Li Jiahua. Li Jiahua was one of the main facilitators during the Occupy. She was the person who designed the process of synthesizing millions of people's voice into 6 points of recommendation. And I was the supporting technological broadcasting infrastructure. After the Occupy, at the end of the year, as I said, people who didn't expect to become mayors become mayors. And people expect them to take the technologies on the street to the city government. It's not that easy. I'm sure you all know it's not that easy. It's a different technology on the street and from one in the city hall. But it's good because the Taipei City Mayor, because he is independent, he has no parties. He says famously when he become the mayor, the entire city council is my opposition. So because of that, he set up a different council, a civic participation council, a citizens council, that is works as a balance with the elected city council. Okay? And this council has three groups, three conveners, one for participatory budgeting, one for open data, and one for participation methods. And Jiahua was the convener of participation methods. And so their first case is the Taipei City budget. We built a website with the occupiers, with the Civic Tech, with GovZero, a website. The website name is just budget.taipei. That's our website. If you go to the website, not necessarily now, you see the Taipei City budget in open spending format with the ones that are increasing floating to the top. They're green. The ones that are decreasing float down to the bottom. They're red. The new budget of this year are black. The recurring budget have a red circle. So at a glance, you can see how large each budget item is like. And then you can separate it by bureau and by office. And you can separate it by the kind of issue that you care about. And we have a standard tree map where you can drill to and see the report they have to the city council associated to just that one park or that one stadium or that one, okay? And because when Mayor Cohen just said, okay, we want to have 5% of our investment budget to be deliberated in participatory budgeting, the main opposition from the city council was that, but the people doesn't understand the city budget. Why are you letting people who don't understand the budget do the budgeting for us? I'm sure you have heard similar things. So, but then this is the education tool then. People can just focus on the part that they understand, that they care about their neighbors, and then click, and then ask questions, informed questions, like why isn't this park built? The budget was from last year. I don't see any construction. What's happening? And people are having discussion over one specific budget item. And to their surprise, 3 weeks after the forum opens, every single question was answered by civil servants working in Taipei City. The mayor told every office to prepare an answer to everything that was collected on the forum here among specific budgets. So they bypassed in a way. You can still go to the MP, the city councilors, to ask these questions, but now you can also ask directly to the civil servants working for the city. There were hundreds of such very good discussions going on. So that was our first work. The work after that was in September last year, and the work after that is much more challenging. It's called social housing deliberation. I'm sure you have social housing here too, right? So by law in Taiwan, 10% of social house must be distributed to people who cannot afford the rent. They are too poor to pay the rent. So 10% of social house must be given to them for free, okay? But the mayor Kuhn-Jus had an additional platform that says 20% more must be distributed to people who can pay for the rent, but no landlord want to rent for them. So status, disadvantaged people. These are people who are alone, elders, very, very old people who live by themselves, aborigine people who don't speak Mandarin that well, single families with many children, mentally handicapped people with like autism, physically handicapped people, people living with immunodeficiency, with HIV, people who are disaster victims, people who were homeless. So these people, even if they have the money, the landlord discriminates against them. They don't often get rented. So the mayor said, okay, 20% of social housing are for these people, but we don't have a law, we don't have a regulation on how to distribute among the people. Do we draw lots? Do we have scoring points? Who is weaker of the weak people? He says, okay, as an occupier, we will need to let the stakeholders decide. We will need these people to decide what is fair to distribute the social house among themselves. But if you think about it, it's impossible to do that with online technology. Maybe 1% of these people are on internet and use Twitter or Facebook. Even if they have a mobile phone, they use mobile phone for other things, not for chatting on Facebook, right, or on Twitter. So if we just set up a forum and expect people to vote or something, 1% of these people will dominate the discussion, and it's not fair at all, okay? So, which is why we made a different process. Because we want to reach all the stakeholders, we use the technology in a way that's assistive, that helps people. Assistive technology is the technology that I used to work when I worked with Apple. We let blind people hear the voiceovers. We work on Siri so they can speak instead of type if they are hard to type in. We provide closed captions for everything that happens on the screen. So we help people with disabilities to participate as normal people, as other people, okay? And then, so for civic tech, we also develop a rolling survey. So we hand to all the social workers in Taipei City saying, who do you know are affected, are one of the stakeholders? Who are experts? And who do you recommend? Who else do you know? And then after they fill in, who else do you know? We send email, we do visits, we do phone calls to reach the people. And then we ask them, who else do you know? And for populations like homeless, it's really the only way to reach the stakeholders because we don't have a census of the address book of the homeless people. It takes many, many ways for us to reach the stakeholders. And then we get the director of social affairs to record on a YouTube holding the due process card of the process that's determined with the stakeholders that says, I don't know what will happen by this consensus method, but I agree as the director of social affairs Taipei to be bound by whatever those consensus determined by the stakeholder of this process. So basically he did what the parliament had did during the Occupy, but before the process. And then we work with the Department of Information Industry and then with the Civil Participation Council and GovZero to form a working group to get all the facts. So not only the house, but also the individual stakeholders. How is their family like? How will they be affected exactly when we change distribution methods? And then we get the stakeholders to see each other, to see how everybody is like. And we do that with technology because some people cannot really leave their home. So we use this kind of virtual reality so they can put on the virtual reality and see other deliberating. And then because some of the people, they don't want to travel to City Hall, we bring the discussion to the place near them and use this kind of camera around 300, 300 euros to put it on the table so it captured the light of everything that was happening during that particular discussion. And so people can watch from afar how it's like. And afterwards, people can still catch up and join the deliberation. And here is where we have the Aborigine people saying, oh, I never really knew how being an autist family feels like. And we have Aborigine people saying, obviously they are weaker than us. I want to give my share to these people. It's what we call empathy. And this cannot happen without this kind of intermediate technology that lets people hear each other. And once the stakeholder agree on the principles, their feelings, what are their common feelings, then we open it up to the citizens, to everybody in the world. And we have face-to-face meetings that was also captured like this. And then it was transcribed, everything was transcribed online. And then in a continuous fashion, so every meeting started with a reading of the consensus of the previous meeting. And finally, we have a consensus meeting that involves all the directors involved, and the director of Aborigine show up and say, okay, I hear my people saying that we native people are not weak, we're not disadvantaged. We are the First Nation. We must negotiate with the city government as First Nation members, not as some disadvantaged group. And I endorse my people's feelings. We will not fight for the 20%. We will fight in another front. And but she cannot do that if not that for that her people have already expressed the sentiment before everybody else. And so the director of Social Bureau discovered through this process, we have a lot more agenda than the distribution. People brought up a lot more, like have a council committee of the people who are disadvantaged, one per group, have people who make a lot of noise, autism people live next to the deaf people so they don't hear the voice. and there's a lot of innovative ideas that was brought up during this process. And because he already said on TV, he agreed to be bound by it, so he has no option but to say, okay, it's green light, everything is in the social housing agenda. There are also the yellow light, which is the thing that he agrees, but it's actually the purview of the director of urban development or of Aborigine of other departments. So he cannot really say that alone, but he agreed to bring it to the mayor and to see whether other directors agree with that. The red ones means we don't have the money for it. We don't have the budget for it. It's not possible in the current budget cycle. But we can bring it to the city council and then say, okay, so these are people's ideas. Are you willing to allocate some money next half year so that people get whatever they want? And so we agree to follow it up every 6 months and see which of the yellow becomes green, which of the red becomes yellow or green. And so it becomes like more like a TV episode where you can follow on the next season based on the result of the previous season instead of starting from scratch. So what looks like a zero-sum competitive game, if you have just two dimensions and a very short 14-day period and have stakeholders shout their ideologies, you can always blow it up to a continuous dialogue so that people hear from one stakeholder group's ideas, the other stakeholder groups build empathy, and so on as the force back and forth until you reach something that really touch the heart of everybody and make decisions based on that. So this is what we say, everybody can vote, right? If you go on Facebook and press like, it's a vote. Everybody can vote. It's for all the population. But before that, we're not challenging voting. We're challenging the bitrate of voting because it's 5 bits of information uploaded every 4 years. It's too small a information rate compared to the thing that you receive from your government, which is terabytes of policy decisions. So it's not symmetric. So during the Occupy, what we did was hacktivism, right? We went into the parliament and we said, we do the legislative job for you. And this is, but it's just a handful of us. It's a very small amount of people who can't really say, you know, Apple, Google, I love working with you, but for the next month, I'm taking an absence and joining people on the street and do, right? We cannot really do it all the time. It's a fraction of our time. It's a fraction of our people who can really do Occupy style activism. But once we become mayors, once I become the digital minister next month, what we will do is to build a ladder between the collectivism and hacktivism so that people first have open data to share to form the basis of understanding, and then maybe a fraction, maybe a majority of people can propose questions like what's this budget about? Why is it here? And to move the dialogue upstream to the why and how, and not to the exactly what after the draft forms. And some of these people are also experts in their own fields. They will be able to provide informed opinions on the questions and form a dialogue, a forum. Of course, by this point, it's less than half of the population, and we accept that, it's true. And then some part of people, the stakeholder groups, will be able to enter the deliberation and use the process to listen to each other and agree on common principles. Again, it's a smaller amount of people, but it's okay. Because every point in this ladder, we build a connection with people from the previous ladder. So people can just take some time to see that the deliberation result, the facts, the evidence actually checks out. If you donate just 1 hour of your time, there's something for you to do. If you have half a day, there's more for you to do. If you have 1 day, 2 days, there's more for you to do. But you can always very comfortably know people in every part of the letter. And finally, we will be able to then use the deliberation results to try to convince other civil servants, try to convince the MPs that, hey, it's a good way to work with people. It's okay to make it binding. It doesn't result in lower quality discussions, it's a higher quality discussion. And then we will have agenda setting power. So just to wrap up very quickly, Dr. Tsai Ing-wen, when she becomes president, she said, before in Taiwan, we only know democracy as a fight between two opposing values. But now we must learn democracy is a conversation between many, many diverse values. We're going to build a unified democracy that is not hijacked by ideology, that is not hijacked by a virus of the mind. We must build an efficient democracy that solves the demands of the society. But most importantly, a pragmatic democracy that lets people take care of each other's feelings and understand each other's feelings. And that's her vision. And as her member of cabinet, I'm building the tools for this just by listening. This is what we call scalable listening, so that millions of people can listen to millions of people. And I'm going to have some demos, but just for people who join us later in the game, we had a conversation here going on actually, that is of this website address. It's called remesh.net/demo, slash lab. Say demo is the French.
That demo that I get.
So this is the URL. You have a phone or anything like that. You can go to remesh.net/lab, lab as in media lab. And then we will take 3 minutes maybe to have a demo with the people here. And then we play some more VR films. Now we see 10 people online at remesh.net/lab. We see 12 people, 13 people. And then for people who joined later, you will see that I already have a conversation with the people before you, asking what you feel at the moment. And then people feel very excited about virtual reality at that time. So what I am going to do now is to ask you to take 3 minutes of your time to think what kind of questions appear in your mind. What would like you like to ask the entire group? What would you like this entire group to think about? Okay, does that make sense? So basically, what is the question you have in your mind for the group to think about? Okay, and I just asked the group for 3 minutes. And then if you have a phone, if you go to remesh.net/lab, you can write down your thinking. And once you're done writing down your thinking, wait a little bit until other people's thinking appears. And then you can compare their question to your own questions. Okay, so we'll take 3 minutes to do that. So I see 18 people participating. And again, the URL is remensch.net/lab. It doesn't have to be a very complex question. You can speak anything, really. Okay, and now for the last minute, we're now in the voting part. You will see ranked voting. For the votes that will compare the questions that people have proposed, and you can rank among them for the next minute. Yago asked a question, because during this time, people click faster, have a better control of the conversation. It's true, which is why we don't actually use Remensch so far in Taiwan's public debate. We use POTUS, which is the same process, but expanded over 3 weeks or 4 weeks. But we don't have 4 weeks for the workshop here, so this is a taste of how it's like. But in reality, it actually converges more. So we have some ideas. How could the public debate move from who's gonna be the next president to how are we gonna build a better democracy? And this is the only one that has majority of consensus, 60%. But there are, like, how can we map all the Taiwan innovation stuff? How can we deliver 3 million people? Or is it possible to do it globally? Now, because I already bound myself to the collective intelligence, now I have to ask this question to the group, right? Otherwise, I lose my legitimacy. So, so how could the public debate move from who's gonna be the next president to how are we going to build a better democracy? Any ideas is fine. We're going to do that for 3 minutes. Now we're moving quickly to the voting period. And again, it is just a very quick demo. A real deliberation using this method will have a lot more structure, a lot more informed material, a lot more of interaction face-to-face among participants. This is a demo of one specific component of the technology. there's many interesting ideas. By reaching out to as many people as possible and listening to those who feel disaffected by party politics. That's actually a very, very good consensus. And to increase engagement, to start talking about liquid democracy, to create a campaign that refuses leadership, and learning from innovations. But this one, I think, is really a highlight. It is the reaching out. We need to make sure that it's not preaching out. Right? So when we reach out to people in Taiwan, in social housing and so on, we reach out just to be there, to listen, to capture this kind of thing. When we ask questions, we ask not only open-ended questions, but meta questions, like what questions do you feel are important? And this is all part of listening, and this is how we really get better as human beings, really, to one another. And so for the next 5 minutes, I'm going to show you a trailer of the beginning of the VR workshop that is going to happen after this, right? And then to show why I am now working on technology that enables people's participation, even for people who don't travel much, or to people who are not interested in normal, regular politics because they feel it's too much of an effort, and they prefer home entertainment. The basic idea of this thought is that we're not making democracy to compete with games. We're making democracy into a game with a purpose. We're not competing it with home entertainment. We're making it home entertainment. And I think this is one way to radically increase people's interest to contribute on public debates. And the reason why of that is that there is this kind of thing called the overview effect. The overview effect, I'm going to play this very short video. We did actually not a rigorous but a qualitative study of the quality of public debate before and after we showed people their place in the solar system, us, and how that relates to the entire global system. And people generally become better people for the deliberation, because then we realize it's really fragile and everything is linked together. And there's a name for that. It's called the overview effect. People who become private astronauts, people like this Richard Barriot, who worked on Ultima, I think, and somebody called Shuttleworth, they paid for a ticket to the space and went back to Earth and become better people. Shuttleworth came back to Earth and founded Ubuntu Linux. And so it actually works when people have seen Earth from that distance and that angle, we really become better people. And then, and so virtual reality takes us there. But it's not only about virtual reality in a mindset, but also to take a worldwide view, like a deliberation at the same day during the COP21 as part of the Paris Accord, which takes effect next month. Taiwan people also express their views in this kind of deliberation using deliberative method, and with three cities, each one 100 people. But we set up huge projection walls, so that in each city, you look to the left and right, you see two other city people. So it's a virtual room of 300 people, and we danced to the same music and so on, and felt a connection, not the South fighting the North, but talking together about the climate change and how it affects Taiwan. And then, of course, we use the same process to talk about Uber, and then we solve that problem. We have a new Uber regulation because of that. But then we discovered there is a limitation to our methodology. We can't talk about abstract things, Uber, regulation, climate change, principles that we can converge very efficiently from huge number of people, millions of people. Or we can talk about very specific social housing, village renovation that affects maybe 1,000 people and then have a very high quality consensus. But we don't have a tool for public projects in between the two extremes. To be very precise, we don't have a methodology for airports. And this is a huge problem in Taiwan, the Taoyuan Airport problem. People believe in different architects' visions, but they really just believe in architects, not in their visions, because they are not really architects. And we see that also in Notre Dame, in Paris, in Tuscany, and then also, it is the same problem, right? It's large-scale construction. How do we efficiently deliberate on that? And so, which is why this is my focus, because people who work in business information system already use this kind of tools. We just need to bring people to it, to have the architect have a way. This is the Unreal Editor. People working in games may probably know the Unreal Engine, but they now have an editor in virtual reality where you can build your games using your body. And then the best thing is that it takes no learning, because you've been learning that. We have been learning that since we were three or so, how to manipulate objects using our body in a three-dimensional space. So first, it lets the architects have a better way to represent their visions. And then we make avatars of the architects. So this is what I did when I was in Paris 2 weeks ago. I just walked into this room full of cameras, and then it just takes 2 seconds. And then I was scanned, and then they built an avatar of me in 3D. And then I used that to an interview with the public television in Taiwan. And I need to do that instead of Skype or FaceTime, because my home Wi-Fi is really slow. My uplink is maybe like 200K per second. If I use a Skype call with these six people, it will be terribly slow. They will lag a lot. My voice will be lost. There will be no empathy. So instead, I use this software, it's open source, called High Fidelity, that uploads my avatar to Taiwan. And then I just transmit my voice, the position of my head, and the position of my hands, which is very low bandwidth. And then, but people still feel that I'm there. So it's just me explaining of the bandwidth. And then we went on to have 1 hour of very high quality discussion. And then to them, I was really appearing before them, right? Those are school children. They were like high schoolers and primary school people. And then I was able to bring my hands into it with leap motion. This is actually also very cheap. And so the leap motion is a sensor of my hand movement down to finger level. So I can use any gesture I like. Now, to use that in deliberation, it's very good for us facilitators, because as part of the space, acoustic design, sound design, I reduce the attenuation to zero, meaning even if you're virtually 500 meters away in a 5 million people square, you can still speak and I will listen as if you're whispering to me. I retain only the direction where you're speaking, not the sound. It doesn't degrade. So I don't need a microphone. Nobody needs a microphone. And then we can also set up it such that the facilitator turns automatically to people who raise their hand. And again, it is something that facilitators do all the time. It occupies a lot of our attention, but it can be done with JavaScript. And then there's also things I would like to make, like people to have their, you know, hands, gestures like this, and then to have an automatic tally of people's consensus as a feeling meter in next as a pie chart, to the facilitator. So the people see a reflection of themselves using hand gestures in virtual reality. And it's all open source and JavaScript, why not? So, and then when we are replaying this, I'm recording this as a lecture. So everything is recorded, and next time in Media Lab or in Hangzhou or in other classes that I teach, people can wear it and enter it as if you're attending the lecture again. And you can pull up a chair and sit in an empty place and then listen to the people around you. And the next person joining the lecture will see you as part of the audience. And so it starts as an empty classroom, but it gradually gets filled up across time so that people can still like have a additive information with no editing or whatever that just expands not only on space but also on time dimensions. Because of time, I cannot really go into more detail, but I'm very passionate about this technology, and you don't really need a headset. It can also be done with normal IMAX, like 3D glasses, polarizing glasses. It is very inexpensive. So when you revisit, you can also do it on an iPad like this. It's collaborative. People see the same virtual objects at the same time. So the last 20 seconds, I'd like you to read you some poetry. So this is when I presented this in New Zealand. They have the Maori people doing a prayer before the conference. So after the conference, at the closing remark, I also wrote a poem. I'd like to read it to you. So when we see Internet of Things, let's make it an Internet of Beings. When we see virtual reality, let's make it a shared reality. When we see machine learning, let's make it collaborative learning. When we see user experience, let's make it about human experience. And whenever we hear that the singularity is here, let us remember the plurality, the multitude of people is here. Thank you so much. Questions, we can have lunch, we can have the us again, if you want. It's up to you.
Si alguien tiene alguna pregunta, así a viva voz, sin usar ninguna herramienta digital, ahora es el momento.
While I'm answering questions, anyone is welcome to come here and put on Oculus Rift to see the space. And we can also pass the space around. Because it really comes in two different form factors. One is the stationary one with the computer, but the other one, which is portable, is actually exactly the same thing. So. You can keep your glass for the computer-based one, but you can take your glass off and just adjust the lens for the gear-based one. So basically just put it on and look around and pass on to another person you would like. Yeah. Okay, and then questions.
¿Alguna pregunta?
Perhaps there is a danger of technology in that the people can become an elite in this kind of participation processes. Do you mean?
Yeah, of course. Yeah. So basically just participate as participants. And then, yeah.
So the question is if there is a trajectory and mean for people who are working in technical matters to become yeah, because for us technical people, it's really a signal problem, a demodulation problem. It's something we instinctively know, that how do we get signal from noise and so on. And so there's a lot of literature already on that. So if you participate just as a supporting role, on one or two of such deliberations, then you will naturally learn the interface to human. that is nevertheless the same principles. That's a very good question. Any other questions? Yes.
I would like to be here. So I think it's very inspiring what you do, but I don't know if you ever think that your idea about ideology, I think it's a very authoritarian, because you denied the possibility of dissent, because I think maybe with you say like the ideology is like a flu, but you have an ideology and you are spreading like a flu in this moment. So I think that if you ever thought about the danger of erase ideology in this
movement. Yeah. Yes, that is a very fair question.
It is true. What we say is deliberation is a vaccine of the mind. But vaccine, as you pointed out, is also a drug, right? It's not saying that vaccine is not a drug, and it's true. And what we call the zero ideology, for example, I release all my work under the Creative Commons Zero license, which is not even a license, right? It means that you can take it and say it's your work. Right, I abandon all copyright and all related neighboring rights. And of course it makes my ideas spread faster, because then you can call it your idea, right? So it is, what you observe is entirely true. This idea of no ideology, this license of zero license, it itself, of course, a virus of the mind also. But what I'm saying is, it's compatible with every other ideology. Just like the Creative Commons Zero is compatible with all the license, it's compatible with proprietary license, it's compatible with copyleft, it's compatible with anything, because I already relinquished everything. So what I'm saying is that we're building a substrate for the other ideologies to dialogue, to maybe come close to each other. But if they don't come close to each other, we're not suppressing them. We're just providing a space that is unlike Facebook. Facebook is divergent because it wants to keep all your time on it. And we're convergent, meaning that we want people to get over with this idea, this issue, and then move on to the next issue. But other than this difference in space, we don't censor, and we don't. We are not against any ideology. So please continue to have your ideology. I'm fine with that. I'm just saying very personally.
So I propose like a break, yeah. And then we will start with the workshop.
Okay. So for the next 3 hours or so, we're going to try a workshop style. This idea is very simple. At the end of November, I will be here in person to mentor a bunch of students working on tools that I was just showing. But 1 week before that I actually arrive in Madrid, around, I don't know, 25 or 24th, I will also be here as a robot. It's fine, you can carry on your conversation. So, The reason why that I'm doing this is that I promised my prime minister that I must not spend more than 2 weeks every month overseas. So now I have to really send my avatars everywhere to do the talking and so on, so that I can still get some job done in Taiwan. So that's the real motivation. And the second thing, though, is that this is not just for me. There's a person whose name is Edward Snowden, who does that all the time. He speaks in all the international conferences just by a place we think in Moscow that we don't really know, right? Somewhere on Earth, maybe not on Earth, somewhere in the world that he is remote driving this thing. And when I saw the way that Snowden does it, I found a few deficiencies in his design. The rotation of the screen is tied to the video camera, so he has to really turn, wait for 2 seconds for it to actually turn, and then see the other angle. So the responsiveness is not that good. And second, it's not immersive because he's viewing it from a flat laptop, I assume. But the idea is that this is only the immediate front and not the surrounding, not the ambience, and it's not connected to the directional sound that he's experiencing. So I try to improve on Stanton's design, and I work with Yago a little bit on that. First, I brought 2 cameras that I will leave it here for until at least December. I have more anyway. So these cameras are omnidirectional, they're fish lens, but they're 4K, meaning that they're really high resolution, and they're also reasonably cheap. So if you have one of this camera on the table, it captures everything within maybe 2 meter radius, all the light, and then you can change the focus by using a different refractional lens on top of it. So it's very handy for the meetings that I mentioned about the homeless people or people, disaster victims, because if you bring them to the city hall, they either become very tense and not really able to speak very well, or they rehearse everything and there's no real conversation. And so instead we bring these tools to their neighbors, have real discussions and deliberations, and capture everything so that people in the city hall can put on this and feel like they're here, they're in different spaces. So this forms the basis of our telepresence technology. So that, as you can see on the top of this proposed design, which I think is inspired by the Big Bang Theory, it is on the top, it is two of these 360 cameras. And the result is that I capture everything in Taiwan, every light, regardless of where the robot is turning to, is sent to Taiwan, so that I can locally wear virtual reality and turn locally. There will be no latency because all the information is there anyway, and I can review even when people are surrounding this robot, every single person, instead of having the robot doing a dance that is self-rotational. So the rotation will be handled in Taiwan locally. That is the first thing. And the second thing that we need people to work on is the screen. Because this is really tricky. My head can turn anywhere in Taiwan, and you will know which direction my eyes are at the moment, but they turn faster than the robots, the wheels, can turn. And am I making my point clear? So basically, I can turn my head like this, but then the robot can't really respond as fast as I do that in Taiwan, which is sub-second. And so by the time my rotational information is sent here, I'm already done turning in Taiwan, I'm back here. So there will be a lag between the rotation. So my initial idea is to just not send the rotational information to hardware. My initial idea is just to have 2 LED lights, maybe a ring of LED light, like Christmas tree. You know Christmas tree, everybody knows Christmas tree. Good. So like Christmas tree, and then the light will just indicate the general direction that I'm looking to. And that can change really quickly because it's just LED, there's no motor, there's no servo involved. And so people can know where my eyes are looking at the moment, but that's it. You don't need to have a picture of me that translates in time. But then if you get really fancy and have a holographic projection of a head that is synthesized locally with the rotational information, of course we can do with that too, but let's not do that in the first prototype. So for this, I think really instead of a face of me, you can try to paint a omnidirectional smile. I don't actually know how you do that, but the design such that it looks more like a the what's the one in Star Wars, R2-D2? the more omnidirectional kind of design, so that it's not a human face, but it feels a little bit like face. Maybe the LEDs can turn purple or turn red or turn something, so it's still some humanity in it, but it only shows where my eyes are looking at instead of a picture of me, which gets really stale after maybe the first 5 minutes anyway. So we can work on synthesizing the face, but it's not a requirement for today. For today, we only need to come up with a design that people think are friendly enough, and that shows the direction of my eyes. Is that okay? That's for the rotational part. So, and then we have a speaker. This is just off-the-shelf speaker, but I think we should also install a microphone here so that if the camera fails, if the audio-visual signal somehow fails, the hardware fails, we can still fall back to audio-only mode. So I will be a blind person and you will help me walk, but otherwise the conversation will still be ongoing. So I'm thinking to have a mic and speaker here, and the mic is a fallback. It's turned off usually, but we can turn it on if the camera fails. And so finally, we have the battery. I don't actually know how the battery will work for this. Is there a battery expert here? Yay! Okay, great. So, because if the hardware is going to be Raspberry Pi based or something like that based, then you have standard battery technology that works with that. Because the hardware here is really only taking the HDMI signal. I have the converters here. This guy sends either a over USB 2 a normal USB cam signal, or it also outputs micro HDMI, which you can capture into a USB camera using the hardware converter here. But this is actually pretty power hungry because it does a hardware translation from HDMI signal into a USB camera signal. So it has to be able to be powered for this and then for these two like converters. So I don't know how the consumption in exact amps, but it will probably be more than a Raspberry Pi itself.
Well, first of all, I would like to change a little bit the format because we are like in a presentation, and we will turn this into a workshop. So maybe we can be like all, not with a microphone, but all very close, maybe here together, or yes.
So,
I would like to know who thinks that can contribute in a technical way to the work that we are going to do.
Technical people.
Yes, technical people can raise hand to see how much we have.
Okay.
Okay.
And people who work on the face, the art people.
Art people?
Okay.
Okay, is there another different profile that we cannot imagine?
Well, I mean, there is also the
programming people.
Yeah, there's also the software, but I can do the software, but I will come about as well. And I mean,
really, for me, the transportation, the wheels underneath it, we don't have to do that or even design that today, because in the I imagine it to be mostly stationary. As long as you have like four wheels under it, just like this chair, or you can even mount it on this chair. That will work, actually. You can just move this chair around. We talked about using a joystick to navigate, but I think it's actually pretty dangerous. If I my cat, for example, a joystick and it bumps into walls, I don't really think it's a really good idea. So I think for the first prototype, I will remain mostly static in this kind of chair. And then if I want to move to a different place, I would just ask for help, like help me to move to the center of the room. I think that would be enough. Yeah, okay?
Yes, but we have planned to do the translation.
I know, but do we have people working on translation?
Yes.
Yeah, so then that will be the third one. It will be disconnected with the head.
Yes.
Yeah, so then there will be three groups. One with the...
So there will be three groups. One working with the head, for lack of a better term, the technical part of taking in the hardware signals and then live streaming it and have an embedded chassis to host it. And then the second technical group working on the translation, that is to say the wheel that could be controlled by a joystick. And the third group working on the art part of it, which is try to find a way to make me look not that ugly from any viewing angle and a way to show where my eyes are pointed at. That's it, that's the three groups.
Yes, and I imagine that if there is some LED showing the direction, it has to be like some electronic control LED.
And I mean, all we have to do now is to produce a design sketch. The implementation will be finished over the next week. So just come up with something that people think makes sense.
So, yes, I think we can just gather around this table, the ones who want to think a little bit about the specifications and organize a little bit the technical part.